In today's session, we are going to deal with section 2.4 of chapter 2, which is dealing with coordinates. So basically, when we are talking about coordinates, a vector space is always having a basis, or it has infinite number of bases. It definitely has one basis. So with respect to each basis, an element can be expressed. So when the element is expressed with respect to the basis elements, you will have certain coefficients coming from the scalar field. That coefficients are properly arranged in a vector form, and that is correspondingly called coordinate. So in order to understand what we are trying to convey, let's see an example. We always talk about Fn over F, which is nothing but Rn over F. Here we have the standard basis to be epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3, etc., epsilon n, which are simultaneously one, the n tuple 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, etc., 0, the second one being the n tuple 0, 1, 0, etc., 0, the third one being n tuple 0, 0, 1, 0, etc., 0, and the last one being etc., and the last one being the n tuple 0, 0, 0, etc., 0, 1. And usually it is arranged in this order, the order we have mentioned here. So if suppose x is a vector coming from Fn, suppose x is the n tuple x1, x2, etc., xn, then this n tuple x1, x2, etc., xn can be written as x1 into epsilon 1 plus x2 into epsilon 2 plus etc. plus xn into epsilon n, right? So this corresponding coefficients will be here the coordinates of the vector x we are talking about. That is, we talked about x coming from Fn over F. The corresponding coordinates with respect to the standard basis will be the coefficients arranged in this manner, x1, x2, x3, etc., xn, in the column vector, as a column vector. As another example, consider R3 over R or F3 over F. Let beta 1 be the standard basis. Okay. So this standard basis is arranged in a particular order. You know that 1, 0, 0, the 3 tuple 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. Right. I am considering a vector from R3, which is the n, which is a 3 tuple minus 2, 3, 1. So this minus 2, 3, 1 can be written as minus 2 into 1, 0, 0, epsilon 1 plus 3 into epsilon 2 plus 1 into epsilon 3. So correspondingly, if x is this vector, x has a correspondence to this column vector, where the column entries will be minus 2, 3, 1, which are the coefficients of this. Another example, script B2 is another basis of R3 over R. You can check this. Do check out while you are lecturing down. Check whether it's a basis. R3. Okay, so I'm telling it's a basis. So what I'm going to do is take the same x, which is the 3 tuple minus 2, 3, 1. I have to write this minus 2, 3, 1 as a linear combination of 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0. So I am writing, say, A into 1, 0, 1 plus B into 1, 1, 1 plus C into 1, 1, 0. And then I am going to solve the system. So you will get A plus B plus C is equal to minus 2 from the first coordinates. then you will have b plus c to be equal to 3, and then you have a plus b is equal to 1, and from these two equations you get c is equal to 3 minus b and a is equal to 1 minus b simultaneously, and then substitute these two values for a and c in the first equation, and finally you will get b is equal to 6, c is equal to minus 3 and a is equal to minus 5, which means that minus 2, 3, 1 is equal to minus 5 into 1, 0, 1 plus 6 into 1, 1, 1 plus minus 3 into 1, 1, 0. So here the vector x is equal to minus 2, 3, 1. This is a vector that has the corresponding coordinates to be the column vector minus 5, 6, minus 3. So this is with respect to script B2. The earlier was with respect to script B1, which was a standard basis. So this is actually an idea of what we are going to do in this section. So here we are saying that the coordinates of a vector alpha in V relative to the basis. Always a coordinate is relative to a particular basis we have fixed, to the basis script B, will be the scalars which it helps us to express alpha as a linear combination of the vectors in the basis. So given a vector alpha, it has a unique expression as a linear combination of the standard basis of the vectors, right? So you have the ith coordinate xi of alpha to be the coefficient of epsilon I in this expression, which was what we had seen here. Here when we write it as a linear combination, we just have to multiply 1 0 0 0 with x1 plus 0 1 0 0 0 with x2 plus etc, right? And also in the second example here, we just have to multiply the standard basis with the corresponding coordinates. It's so easy to just identify. But when we are dealing with bases which are not standard bases, we have to find out, right? We have to do some work out some steps. So that's what that statement means. So we talked about the bases having an order. So the first definition is that if V is a finite dimensional vector space, an ordered basis for V is a finite sequence of vectors which is linearly independent and spans V. So definitely ordered basis is a basis, but the order of the vectors, the elements inside the basis should be specified. If it is given as a sequence, then the order will be specified. So it is a finite sequence. So if we are thinking about R3 over R, the vector space R3 over R, we know epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon 3 are forming the basis. So to make it an, you can even write the same basis like this, epsilon 2, epsilon 1, epsilon 3, according to our convenience. But we have to, when we are dealing with this section, we have to mention which order we are taking. Suppose if we are taking this order, we have to say that the first basis element is epsilon 2, the second one is epsilon 1, and the third one is epsilon 3. So if we are taking this basis, then we have to mention that the first basis element is epsilon 1, the second one is epsilon 2, the third one is epsilon 3. And generally, we always tend to take the first sequence while dealing with the standard basis of Fn's or Rn's. Okay. So if the sequence alpha 1, etc., alpha n is an ordered basis for V, then the set alpha 1, etc., alpha n is a basis for V. Okay, so we usually notate it with script B, which is equal to set alpha 1, etc., alpha n. So, okay, suppose if V is a finite dimensional vector space, suppose the dimension of V is equal to N, and assuming that script B is equal to set alpha 1, etc. alpha N is an ordered basis for V. Given alpha in V, there is a unique N tuple x1, etc., xn of scalars such that alpha is equal to x1 alpha 1 plus x2 alpha 2 plus etc. plus xn alpha n. That is true, right? Because script B is the basis for V. So alpha can be written as a linear combination of these elements. Now, the claim we are going to make is that such a possibility is unique. That is, if we are writing alpha as a linear combination of alpha 1, alpha 2, etc., alpha n, that linear combination will be unique. For that, we are assuming that suppose if alpha is equal to the linear combination of alpha 1, etc., alpha n with some other coefficients. That is, here the coefficients were x1, x2, etc., xn. We are assuming that the coefficients here are z1, z2, etc., zn. So both of them are the same. That means we can equate them. Summation I is equal to 1 to n xi alpha I is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n zi alpha I. Then subtract. Then you get summation I is equal to 1 to n. Coefficient is xi minus zi into alpha I is equal to 0. But alpha i's are from the basis. So this is actually the linear combination of all the elements inside the basis equated to 0. But these are linearly independent. The alpha is a linearly independent. That will mean that all the coefficients should be equal to 0. That means xi minus zi is equal to 0 for every I, which will mean xi is equal to zi. So our claim is proved. That means the n tuple we are talking about is unique. So we shall call xi the ith coordinate of alpha relative to the ordered basis. If script B is equal to the basis set alpha 1, etc., alpha n, and we know that alpha is equal to we are taking that alpha is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n say xi alpha I. Suppose if this is so, and we know that beta is some other element in the vector space, so beta should also be able to be written as a linear combination of alpha I's. Suppose if beta is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n yi alpha I, then alpha plus beta is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n xi plus yi into alpha I, right? So the ith coordinate of the vector alpha plus beta in V in this ordered basis is xi plus yi. So this just means that, I'll just give you an idea. Here we have written alpha with respect to the basis beta we are talking about. You have the coefficients to be x1, x2, etc., xi, etc., xn. Okay. And with respect to beta, you have the coordinates with respect to the basis beta. Script B, you have the coordinates to be y1, y2, etc., yi, etc., yn. And then finally, what we have observed is that if alpha plus beta, the vector alpha plus beta, here alpha comma beta comma alpha plus beta are all elements inside the vector space we are talking about. The coordinates of alpha plus beta with respect to the basis B, ordered basis B, will be x1 plus y1, x2 plus y2, plus etc., plus xi plus yi, plus etc., plus xn plus yn. That's what we have talked about. Now, similarly, suppose if we are talking about the vector C alpha now, then the vector C alpha will have the corresponding coordinates with respect to the ordered basis script B, and the coordinates will be CX1, CX2, etc., CXI, etc., CXN. So, as we said earlier, this alpha, beta, alpha plus beta, C alpha, everything belongs to the vector space we are talking about. So, what we just obtained is that whenever we have a vector space V, having the dimension of V to be N, okay, then any vector alpha which belongs to V will have a 1-1 correspondence to an n tuple, where this x1, x2, etc., xn belongs to the scalar field of the vector space V. So there is a 1-1 correspondence between each vector in V and to all the n tuples which can be formed from Fn. So frequently, as we said earlier, we usually denote the coordinates using a coordinate matrix of alpha relative to the ordered basis script B, and we write it as the column vector x1, x2, etc., xn to indicate that. Also, we denote it as in the braces alpha, and to the base we write the script P. This is the notation of the coordinate matrix of alpha relative to the ordered basis. So suppose if V is an n-dimensional space and V is having two ordered bases, beta and beta dash, say. So there are definitely unique scalars such that this each alpha I dash, I'll call alpha 1 dash, can be written as a linear combination of alpha 1 to alpha n, etc. Like this, alpha 1 can be written as a linear combination of alpha 1, alpha 2, etc., alpha n, alpha 2 dash can be written as a linear combination of alpha 1, alpha 2, etc., alpha n, and likewise till alpha n dash. You can do that because alpha 1, etc., alpha n is a basis. So every element inside a vector space should be written as a, written as a linear combination of the elements in the basis. So that's how we get that. Now suppose if x1 dash, etc., xn dash be the coordinates of a given vector alpha in the ordered basis, script B dash, then that will mean that alpha can be written as x1 dash, alpha 1 dash, plus etc., plus xn dash, alpha n dash, because it is corresponding to the ordered basis script B dash, right? So that can be written as summation j is equal to 1 to n xj dash alpha j dash, which is equal to summation j is equal to 1 to n xj dash. We already said that alpha j dash can be written like this. So the equations is summarized to this form. Okay, so you can interchange alpha j dash to summation I is equal to 1 to n p I j alpha I. Then just take this x I to this side, because p I j and x j dash are in the field, we can and they commute with respect to multiplication. So you can take it inside and then treat this part as 1, okay, and put the braces there, and also exchange. Here you have j is equal to 1 to n, I is equal to 1 to n. Here you'll have to exchange I and j. That's okay, fine, right? Because summation and addition, they distribute, associate and commute everything, right? And so what you obtained is alpha is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n into something into alpha I's. But what are alpha I's? Since this alpha 1, alpha 2, etc., alpha n form the basis, the first basis, script B. So suppose if x1, x2, etc., xn are the corresponding coordinates, so we will be able to write alpha as a linear combination of them. X1 alpha 1 plus x2 alpha 2 plus etc. plus xn alpha n, or summation I is equal to 1 to n xi alpha I, right? But this, we said that this will be always a unique linear combination. So you obtain alpha is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n xi alpha I, as well as alpha is equal to summation I is equal to 1 to n into this term into alpha I. So that will mean that xi should be equal to this quantity. So that is an observation you get from there. Now let P be an n by n matrix whose ijth entry is written as a scalar Pij, and let x and x dash be the coordinate matrices of the vector alpha with respect to script B and script B dash. That simply means that alpha with respect to script B is equal to capital X, the column vector, and alpha with respect to beta dash is equal to X dash. So you can see it here. Fine. So as we had earlier observed, we can reformulate this equation xi is equal to summation over j pij xj dash as, where I is varying from 1 to n. You can formulate it in the matrix form. So that will be x is equal to px dash. You can see here. Okay. Now we have a script B and script B dash to be linearly independent sets. Then suppose if x dash is equal to 0. So if x dash is equal to 0, then that will mean x dash will be the column vector x1 dash, x2 dash, etc., xn dash, right? So x dash is equal to 0 will imply x1 dash is equal to x2 dash plus equal to xn dash is equal to 0. So all these terms will be 0. That will imply definitely x is equal to 0, because when we multiply this with this, you get all of them to be 0. Now suppose if x is equal to 0, okay, x is equal to 0. X is equal to 0 will imply x1 is equal to, x2 is equal to, etc., xn is equal to 0. That will imply alpha, which was the linear combination of x1 alpha 1 plus etc. plus xn alpha n, right? Since all the x are 0, this will be equal to 0, right? So that means alpha is 0. So that means 0 is equal to alpha. Alpha can also be written as a linear combination of xj's and xj dash and alpha j dash. So this 0 is equal to x1 dash alpha 1 dash plus x2 dash alpha 2 dash plus x etc plus xn dash alpha n dash. But alpha 1 dash alpha 2 dash etc alpha n dash are in the basis script b dash. So they are linearly independent. That means the coefficient should be 0. X1 dash is equal to x2 dash is equal to etc xn dash is equal to 0. That will mean the x dash is equal to 0. So now we proved x dash is equal to 0 if and only if x is equal to 0. We proved both ways. So that's the statement sitting over here. Since beta, script B and script B dash are linearly independent sets, x is equal to 0 if and only if x dash is equal to 0. So also from the first chapter, you have a theorem which says that if A is an n by n square matrix, then A is row equivalent to n by n identity matrix if and only if the system of equations Ax is equal to 0 has only the trivial solution. So A is row equivalent to n by n identity matrix means that is invertible. So here we have x is equal to Px dash. So that will mean, suppose if x is 0, so that means Px dash is equal to 0. So Px dash is equal to 0 if and only if x dash is equal to 0. That is the idea we get from that. Okay, so from this theorem, theorem 7, you get that P is an invertible matrix. So since P is an invertible matrix, what we can do? We can, instead of x is equal to Px dash, you can have x dash is equal to P inverse x, right? So you have that, and then we can rearrange reformulate both these equations like this. Because x we know to be notated as like this, x dash we know how to notate like this, and so it forms like that. And theorem 7 is actually the summarizing what we have discussed so far. You can read out the statement and understand how we proved theorem 7. So when you write the lecture notes, you will have to first write theorem 7 first and then write the corresponding proofs. So theorem 8 says, suppose if P is an n by n matrix, then invertible matrix, let V be an n dimensional vector space over F, and let script B be an ordered basis of V. Then there is a unique ordered basis script B dash of V such that alpha relative to script B is equal to the matrix is equal to P into the matrix related matrix of alpha relative to script B dash. Alpha over script B dash is equal to P inverse of alpha over B. So this is actually a kind of reformulating what theorem 7 said. Not reformulating, actually a kind of converse. So suppose if script B consists of vectors alpha 1 etc alpha n, and if beta dash is equal to the set alpha 1 dash etc alpha n dash, suppose if it be a set of elements of V, which satisfies 1. Okay, suppose if it satisfies 1. So if it satisfies 1, definitely we know that this is equal to the equality sitting here. Okay, according to what we had seen earlier, right? So okay, so we need to show that alpha j dash defined by these equations form a basis. So suppose if q is equal to p inverse, we know that p is invertible, so we have no offense doing that. So for particular k, what we are going to do is we are going to multiply q on both sides of the equation. Okay, so you will have q with, and the matrix, the first matrix with respect to beta is equal to q p, then the matrix with respect to beta, here the matrix with respect to beta dash, and here the matrix with respect to beta, and then rearrange the summations again, and you have p and q together coming, and when they are summed up, we know that will form the identity matrix. And when it is multiplied, you get the vector itself. So what you obtained is that if we are these are actually the rows of the matrix Q and P coming there. Okay, that's how it is operated. So when we talk about in totality, what's happening here is we have the Q here, and then the alpha with respect to beta dash coming here, and then you have the Q here, P here, alpha with respect to beta. This is what is actually happening, and we are doing the rows here. That's why you have the summation and stuff, and only one row is coming because we are taking a particular k. So that means the linear combination of alpha j's will lead to the elements alpha 1, alpha 2, etc., alpha n, which are coming from the basis script B. So that means the subspace spanned by the set alpha 1 dash, etc., alpha n dash will form the basis script B, right? It contains script B. Script B is already a basis. So definitely that subspace will be equal to V. Right. So here this script B dash is a subset of V. It has n vectors and it spans V. Then automatically with the help of earlier theorems in the dimensions, we can understand that this script B dash is a basis by theorem 7 from earlier theorem. So you can conclude theorem 8 like that, and 2 also follows like that. Now example 18 is the one which we discussed at first with respect to the standard basis, how we treated standard basis and how we formed the coordinate matrix earlier. Example 9 talks about a matrix called a rotation matrix. It is an important matrix. You know that the matrix will be having the determinant to be equal to 1 when you calculate bit of P. And also you'll be able to find the inverse, P inverse, as the matrix sitting here. And there is an example of a basis script B dash consisting of two vectors. The first ordered pair is cos theta sine theta. Second ordered pair is minus sine theta cos theta. It is a basis for R2. You have to prove that. Check it out. And you can see how the linear combination of the vectors are coming, and coordinate matrix and all. The coordinate matrix is how it is made here. And also you have an example 21 which also you can work out the given matrices are P, you can find the P inverse and then vectors alpha 1 dash, alpha 2 dash, alpha 3 dash are all given, and then you get finally the conclusion from there. So you can work out the examples as well as work out all the exercises in this section. So thank you for watching out, and see you in the next video.